Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 1 p.m. Stay tuned next for Terra Verde.
From the Amazon basin, from the magnificent redwoods of California to the icy majesty of the Arctic, life on Earth faces an unprecedented threat from careless development. Join Terra Verde over lunch today to find out about the unfolding future of the planet.
Good afternoon and welcome to Terra Verde, your weekly environmental affairs show. I'm Brian Edwards Tiekert. Coming up today, natural solutions to unnatural disasters. When volunteers first hit Bay Area beaches to help clean up the fuel spill, officials turned them back and even handcuffed a few who refused to leave. The fuel was toxic, they said, and no one should be around it without hazardous materials training, which they didn't start providing for volunteers until almost a week after the spill. Now the volunteers are teaching officials some lessons of their own. I'm joined in KPFA's studios by someone who's been using a very unconventional method to clean up the spill. She's distributed thousands of human hair mats that volunteers are using to sponge up the fuel, and she says it's working better than what the pros have. Lisa Gauthier is the executive director of Matter of Trust, an ecological public charity in San Francisco. Welcome to Terra Verde on KPFA.
Hi, thanks very much.
So let's start off a little bit about the conventional approach to dealing with an oil spill. What do you see as the problems?
Well, I think that, first of all, usually oil spills are tanker spills. Well, I shouldn't say that. Large, the ones that get noticed in the press. There were actually 2,600 oil spills last year, I believe, or was the year before. But it's roughly about that number every year. And basically, there's a lot of general maintenance oil spills. There's a lot of harbor spills and things like that. But the ones that get noticed are tanker spills often. And when you have a revenue-generating system where oil is used to clean up oil, because most of the cleanup products are petroleum-based, it's hard for green products to sort of break into the system. And especially because it's hard to break into the system anyway, and once you're in, it's hard to get noticed because things are already being ordered and then just reordered and reordered and reordered. But if you can show that a green product works better, to try to show the people who can license it and can order it in the middle of a panic situation where they're just absolutely stressed, you know, and worked, you know, to the limit, it's not a good time to do it. And I think the only reason that it's working this time is because it's in the San Francisco Bay Area, and San Franciscans, people from Berkeley, from Bolinas, from Pacifica, everybody is more likely here, I think, to just kind of nudge, push ahead, and just try to say, look, let's look at this there must be a silver lining here. Let's look at the green alternatives.
And it's not just a question of sustainability. I understand some of the products they've used to clean up oil spills include dispersants, I guess, that are used to break up the oily sheen, but they contain industrial solvents that are toxic, that have harmful effects to people who are exposed to them.
Right, it's hard for the, I think it's hard, you know, for the crews that have to clean up all the time. You know, anything that you can have that is green or natural is better for the people working out there. And, you know, it's better if you're putting the stuff in the water. It's better for the ecosystems that it's on. And, you know, for example, one of the things we're going to talk about are hair mats, which are they're absorbent.
Okay, let's talk about hair mats.
Okay, let's talk about
how did you get interested in using hair mats to clean up oil?
Well, if I could just first let me just say that one of the alternative, hair mat is, I guess, called the alternative, because the norm are mats that are petroleum based. I think they're called pig mats or haz mats. And, you know, I think that the crews try to be very careful to pick up absolutely everything because, first of all, it has toxic, you know, waste on it and bag it up and put away. But if, for some reason, something does fly away, you know, and then a bird swallows parts of that or something, it's, you know, it's like swallowing plastic bags and stuff. So it's much better, you know, as with everything, as all of your listeners know, it's better to go green whenever possible. And now, especially because we're showing that it's a superior product, you know, everybody's jumping on board, which is nice.
Okay. Let's talk about that superior product. You are moving the sweepings from barbershops to the beaches of San Francisco. How did this idea occur to you?
Okay, so it didn't occur to me. I run a public charity, an ecological public charity, and we concentrate on man-made surplus and natural surplus and eco-education. And so we get a lot of people telling us about different things. And after the Exxon Valdez, there was a hair designer, a barber, named Phil McCrory, and he was watching the Exxon Valdez footage on CNN, and he saw the otters covered in oil and the water around them relatively cleaner, and he said, oh, of course, I shampoo, you know, oily hair all day long. Of course, hair is very good at this. So, you know, they did tests, and they found out that actually hair is not only very good at it, it's the best. it just sloops up oil. And so the... He invented these mats, and he tried to get everybody to notice. And like we said, it's hard to break into, you know, to this market. There was another oil spill a few years later, and I had gotten the articles about, you know, all the stuff he'd been doing. He was on CNN, he was, you know, on BBC. It made quite a flare, but then it didn't just get picked up. So when the next oil spill came along, people were saying, you know, what have you thought about this oil spill? And I said, oh, I was sort of assumed that it was getting picked up by the hair. And everybody's like, what hair? And I thought, uh-oh. So I started calling every hairdresser I could find in Alabama, in Huntsville, Alabama, and we found Phil McCrory. He's an amazing guy. In fact, he's flying out here today. He's going to be available, hopefully, for some of the training sessions coming up this weekend. If people want to meet him, we'll have his agenda on our website. And he said, you know, I haven't been able to make anything go with it, except that it also, hair mats also happen to be great for growers because they happen to block weeds from growing up, and they happen to be a slow nitrogen release, so they're a good fertilizer. And the rose growers and tomato growers and tulip growers just love them. So, and also collecting hair in the United States is really difficult. It's not a commodity. But in China, it is a commodity. And so they were buying the hair and having the mats manufactured in China and selling them here to growers. So I said, well, you know, we would love to try to see if we can get, because hair salons, you know, let's see if they want to mail in their hair clippings and donate them to our charity and see if we could try a microeconomy thing here. And he said, go for it. And so they've donated, he's now with smartgrow.net, and they've donated for our charity, matteroftrust.org, to have the license to be able to manufacture these mats and collect hair. They own the patents. Smartgrow.net owns the patents.
So explain to me exactly how you're using the hair mats out here in the Bay Area. When did you start getting them out to the beaches?
Well, so 48 hours after the spill, everybody in the environmental community, I think, was starting to go, how's it going out there? And people all started to email each other and start poking around at the beaches. And some of the beaches had been closed off. But one beach that had not been closed off was Ocean Beach. And another beach that was soft closed was Baker Beach at that point, although now it's closed. Actually, they're both closed officially. But San Francisco Department of the Environment, Cynthia Knowles, is this amazing lady, and she actually worked with me to get a whole bunch of hair mats for her used motor oil campaign, you know, awareness campaign in San Francisco. So I knew that she had about 800 hair mats available in San Francisco. And we had a whole bunch of hair mats as well at Matter of Trust. And so we started looking around and saying, you know, we went to Central Command and asked them if they wanted some, and they said they'd get back to us. But then we went out to the beaches, and we saw that there were these surfers. They're with, they're now called Kill the Spill, Byron Cleary and hundreds of them out there. And they were, at first, you know, they were all just looking. They're like, you know, we like to surf. We can't surf in this. Look at this oil sheen on the water. Look at this black stuff all over the beaches. And this was 48 hours. It was still relatively bad on the beaches. And I was out there, and I was seeing that there were kids making sandcastles, and they were using the oil as decoration on it. And I thought, oh, God, this beach has to be closed. You know, we have to do something. This is crazy that it's not closed yet. So... But anyway, they said, you know, we're going to get a whole bunch of surfers together, and we're going to come out, and we're going to, like, you know, wear gloves and everything, but we're going to start cleaning this up because there's nobody out here right now, because I think that they were stretched. There was a huge spill, and I know that the people working on this had a lot to do. It wasn't like they weren't doing anything. I think there might have been some communication, little gaps, but I think everybody was really working very hard. But anyway, the point was is that this beach was not getting touched, and there was this huge impulse, a philanthropic impulse to help, and we saw it. And so we said, okay, look, if you're going to be out here –
somewhat dangerous. Let's see. We called Cole Hardware, which is a hardware store in San Francisco. It's very green. They donated 40%. We paid the other 60% and got them these Tyvek suits. Starbucks started donating coffee, got a tent. You know, it's just like all kinds of things. And the first day, there was about 80 people out there. We got them the hair mats, and they were screaming, "We love these mats," because they just slooped up the oil off the sand. And this was great, because everything we had done with it would been in water, but this was just like, we couldn't believe how this Bunker C fuel was just liquid enough, you know, that at that early stage, it would just like sloop up right off. People were just dabbing these mats everywhere and just, you know, soaking it up. And so then San Francisco Environment donated all 800 and started cutting them up because they were 2 feet by 3 feet. And so they had volunteers that were cutting up the mats, volunteers handing out the suits, people dressing them up. They had volunteers out on the water, you know, taking shifts because they didn't want to be out there where long as toxic and everything. And then the next day it was pouring rain and still 250 people showed up. And then the next day, way over 500 people showed up because it was windy, but it was sunny. And we were talking to officials. There were officials walking by. Everybody knew what we were doing. I was telling everybody what we're doing. Everybody knew in there. It was, you know, it was a soft closure. Everybody knew. Everybody was trying to help. And there's a lady named Michelle Roga, I believe, from the Environmental Protection Agency. And she was talking with Cynthia Knowles from the San Francisco Department of the Environment and Jared Blumenfeld, who's director over there. And they were like, well, let's see if we can get some sort of certification for these people since they're out there. Let's give them training. Let's make sure they're doing this right, you know, so that nobody's endangering anybody. And so she set this up, and it was with National Parks and Rec. And so now they started having these training sessions, and the training sessions are just getting bigger and bigger just to show how, I mean, people coming from all over, East Bay, North Bay, South Bay, everywhere. There was this is like the fourth one in, I think. They had one the other night at Golden Gate Park. They were expecting, you know, 350 people. They had 800 people show up. They had to break it into two sessions, and they still had to turn people away. Blocks long lines, three people wide, for trying to get certified to help. So I think that we're revolutionizing oil spill cleanup. That's what we're saying.
So in other parts of the Bay Area, there was some friction between initial volunteers and officials who had closed the beaches. Volunteers were forced to leave some beaches. A couple were led away in handcuffs because they refused to leave because they wanted to help clean up. That wasn't the case so much on Ocean Beach?
No. And I'd heard about that. And actually, I've been in contact with the gentleman who was tasered, I believe, and stuff. And I believe that was at Muir Beach. We've talked to some people, for example, in Bodega Bay. In Bolinas. And they were saying that they... you know, that they've been talking to officials because they are actually not on a soft closure beach, and there's people that live on these beaches and they want to go out there, and they've been talking to officials saying, you know, how can we, you know, work through this? And I think now, because of all the press, and the press, I have to say, you've been the heroes that you were for Katrina. I mean, this has really been pushed by the press, because if we had just been out there, these few people, we could have, you know, gotten in a lot of trouble. But everybody was just like, no, come on, this is amazing. This is such a, like, a tidal wave of help. I think that, you know, the officials realized. I think in the beginning, everybody was scared. First of all, we didn't know how carcinogenic it was. Luckily now, as you will hear at the training sessions, that, you know, it's relatively mild. And of course, everybody doesn't know. There's not a lot of facts. I suggest people wear face masks just to be sure, because we just don't know. You hear things now about, you know, people that worked at 9/11 and things you find out about 7 years later, 6 years later. So, but I think that, you know, people, there was a panic. They was like, oh, we can't just let all these people come out here and touch this stuff, and then they'll sue us, you know, for getting some sort of disease later and all that kind of stuff. So, and, you know, not everybody knows how to deal with every situation, you know, when you're right there on the ground. But in general, I would say that all of the agencies actually have been extremely helpful with this effort.
Well, let's talk a little bit about that. You've got hundreds of volunteers out there on Ocean Beach soaking up droplets. I'm sorry. We have.
Kill This Spill is one of, like, sort of the leaders of all of that, with Zunasurf.com and stuff. And SF Surfriders has been really great pushing people. But really, it's like we're calling them concerned citizens. They're just coming from everywhere. And all we've been able to do is kind of be a place for the product idea of it. We've been looking at, like, what are the greenest things? What can we find as a silver lining for this thing? And so the two biggest things, because we've been working on them for years, that we knew about were the hair mats, because, you know, thousands of salons have been mailing in hair to us for years. And we, you know, whenever we can, we get a run, we show it to schools and we show it to, you know, demos, and we give it to people that have oil soaked birds and all that kind of stuff. But we've never had a situation like this where everything came together. And then it also happened on the weekend of the Green Fest. And, the Green Fest in San Francisco often has Paul Stamets, who's this guru. I had no idea exactly. I mean, I knew he was great, and I've known him for years, but he has a following like a beetle. This guy, when we said, you know, that Paul Stamets was going to donate $10,000 worth of oyster mushroom spawns, oil-eating mushrooms, we got flooded with people going, oh, we love him.
So Paul Stamets is a mycologist.
He is.
And he's been working a lot on using mushrooms to break down toxic waste. He's got some government research contracts for that. He's a frequent guest on the airwaves here. So let's get into his involvement. You have these hundreds of volunteers out scooping up oil and soaking up oil with the hair mats.
And we're trying to contain them in these special places so we just have oil and hair.
So where does it all go at the end of the day?
Well, it's all going, at first, it was going into these bags and, you know, that we were putting on tarps and making sure they're in a special spot. Then it got put into containers off the beach where it's supposed to be with all the other agencies that are cleaning up, because now everybody's certified. So now it's not like there's the volunteers and the agencies. Now they're all together, right? And they're all putting their waste into these containers. And now our big hope, and this is what the next thing that we're working on, is that because Paul Stamets has donated $10,000 worth of mushroom spawn, and he's got a huge following of fungi people. He's with fungi.com, Fungi Perfecti. And they have all kinds of people that also work with us in the Bay Area. So we have now gotten donations of other, same thing, oyster, mushroom, spawn, you know, but more of it than what he's bringing down from Washington. So the situation now is, now he has specialized hazmat teams that will be dealing with this stuff. What we need now is the O'Brien's group, who are the contracted cleanup people. They're the ones out in the boats and everything. First of all, we're hoping that today or very shortly that all of the licensing and everything will be approved for the hair mats, for them to be able to use behind their boats to help clean up the sheen and however else they want to use them. Because already all the cities are using them. And then the next thing is that we're hoping that we can work together to get some of these containers, because we have the containers out there and we know that they're full of hair and oil, to us, so that we can do this. Now I'm going to say this right. It's best management proof of concept, I think it's called. And it's also going to be like an exhibit. And there's different places that have offered to do it. We've actually been talking to people in Berkeley, on the waterfront. There are some places. And this is toxic material, so we have to be very careful. But it will be made into a lasagna with straw and this mushroom spawn that will grow into these huge, beautiful oyster mushrooms. And it will turn closer as the weeks go by into a non-toxic compost. And this is what we're trying to show people, because it's just this extremely odd situation. I mean, it's a very rare situation. First of all, that you have these consolidated places of just hair and oil in massive amounts, that you have all of these volunteers that have, you know, collected that in one area, and then that it happened in the same weekend, so we have all the mushrooms in the same area, and that also we have all the agencies now, everybody willing to work with everybody and looking at this. It seems like the perfect time to show how this is not only a green way to do it, but it's actually a better way to do it, and it's actually a beneficial outcome as opposed to a sort of, you know, a toxic mess at the end that you have to dispose of. The oyster mushrooms are actually edible at the end. I don't know if I'd eat them, but...
Well, I want to get more into that in just a minute, but first I want to remind our listeners that you are listening to Terra Verde on KPFA 94.1 FM in Berkeley, KPFB 89.3 FM in Berkeley, KFCF 88.1 FM in Fresno, or anywhere in the world via www.kpfa.org. You can find us here on Fridays at 1 p.m., and if you miss a show, you can listen anytime through our online archives at kpfa.org. I'm Brian Edwards Tiekert, and my guest is Lisa Gauthier, Director of Matter of Trust. Matteroftrust.org, I would imagine you're getting a lot more hits on your website these days.
Yes, we have been absolutely bombarded with it, which is wonderful. And all the years that we've been in existence, you know, we've gotten little bits of press. We got a lot of press when one of our big programs, Excess Access, got on into Oprah's magazine and things like that. We've had, and National, I'm sorry, A bunch of magazines picked it up after that, and that was good. But that was a blip compared to what we've had from this. This has been hundreds of thousands.
Well, let's talk about next steps. You're sopping up the oil with these hair mats. Then you're collecting the hair mats and hoping to grow mushrooms on them to break down the oil into non-toxic compounds. But I would imagine the big picture is that you want to make this part of standard practices for dealing with oil spills. How are the agencies that deal with those protocols taking to this?
I have to say, everybody's being extremely helpful. I know that some of the people are extremely overworked right now, and we're trying to do everything we can to be as little bother to them as possible. But at the same time, it's very hard for everybody to pass up this opportunity to push green products, especially when they're superior. And it's not only us pushing it, it's all of the agencies are pushing it. They're like, you know, get us more. And so far, everything's been donated. SF Surfrider just bought $5,000 worth of hair mats, and they're donating them, you know, in. And, you know, the Smart Grow, who does it for the rose growers, they donated $1,000.
Out of curiosity, how many hair mats does $5,000 buy you?
These ones are, it buys you a 10,000 hair mat. These ones, they're round, they're 10-inch rounds that they're providing. And so that's plenty. And it could be plenty to go off a boat and help with the sheen. That's what we're hoping. So, because they can, that way they can start with a donated amount and see how it works, you know, before they commit. We think, well, certainly we know that a lot of the city agencies, I think, are very interested now. that's nice, because they're all seeing it. They're like, whoa, this is great. And then the second thing is the contractors are seeing it, so we're hoping that they will go for that as well. And again, we have this unusual situation that this is not a tanker spill. This is a cargo ship spill. This is Bunker C fuel. It's good, great to show that this works as well on Bunker C fuel as it does on crude. If this were crude, these mats can be wrung out and reused up to 100 times. So you could salvage it. There's not a whole lot of point of salvaging the Bunker C fuel unless you're going to be making compost out of it. And this compost, you know, within 12 weeks, depending if the weather where we're hoping to do this can stay between 55 and 70 degrees of the ground temperature where we're hoping to do this composting, this lasagna of the hair, oily hair mats and the mushrooms, you know, it can be a freeway landscape grade compost within 12 weeks.
So if you weren't composting the fuel that's getting scooped up from the spill, where would that fuel be going?
We don't know. Right now, all of the fuel is in the containers that the O'Brien's group has provided for everybody. And that's their job. They've been great about that.
And they're the main contractor for the
cleanup.
They
are for the responsible party. That's what we've been told. And they can't, their hands are tied. They can't do anything more than what they're allowed to do according to licensing. So they're doing everything right. And as soon as the licensing goes through, we hope that they're going to jump on this as well, even though knowing that the last thing they probably want to do is order a bunch of stuff right now because they probably have warehouses full of stuff. But because it's good for them, too. It's good for PR, too, for their company. Again, it's not an oil company. So the cargo ship might like, you know, the PR, and especially since it's a much lighter product than, you know, having to shovel with pails. So less workman's comp. It's easier to handle. It's faster, so it's more efficient for them. So there's, you know, again, there's sort of that's why there's no reason for them not to want to use it. Plus the fact that it's compostable.
And I should say that we tried to get Paul Stamets on the show today, but when we called his office, his press assistant said he was too busy creating the mushroom spawn that he's hoping to contribute to the cleanup effort
it's
to talk
fault.
With anyone from the press.
He's blaming us. No, he's wondering. I actually got a hold of him. He should have talked to me.
So what,
I had him on my cell before I walked in here.
what challenges are you facing now in terms of making this mushroom lasagna compost experiment work out?
Right. So we're very hopeful. We have been, so many people have been calling in with suggestions, and this is great. And it's people from government agencies and all the garbage companies and people that have huge cement slabs that, you know, can provide it. The situation is that it starts out toxic waste and it ends up compost. Both of these things have all kinds of regulations. And you know, we think that, you know, I'm sure that there's all kinds of people, they're not in my backyard kind of thing, you know, this is toxic waste. We're hoping that we've talked to some people. There's places in Berkeley, perhaps, but there's, and we've been, we've been talking to people at Stop Waste in NorCal, and everybody's been very helpful coming up with solutions. But the airport happens to have a whole bunch of, sewage treatment areas that are 40 feet by 40 feet and about 3 feet deep that we can line with tarps. And we're now looking into that. We have to get a permit from water control and water quality control, and we're looking into that today. We've just heard about this today. They're excited about it. They have a meeting on Tuesday at 9 o'clock in the morning. We're trying to get all the paperwork ready for that. It can be an exhibit for the airport, and it's in a way that, you know, the airport can be involved in this. It's far away from everybody. They have the perfect setup for it. It's a sewage treatment situation, and they don't use all of these areas. So that would just sort of be the ideal. Paul and I are praying to the eco god in the sky that this one works out. This is great. When they suggested that, we were like, oh, yes, let's try that. That would just be the synergistic, you know, epitome of this whole situation.
So the third part of this picture, you've got the mats to clean up the spill. You're working on the mushrooms to break down the spill. You're trying to build a green jobs program around this as well?
Yeah, so, yeah, just because, you know, why not? If it just keeps growing and growing better and better. We've been talking, so the warehouse that we have, that we're using now, where all the salons mail in their hair, and they pay for their own postage for this. So it's expensive for salons, and salons are the best. First of all, people come back there every 6 weeks, and they talk in salons. Everybody talks. So there's, like, posters up about the hair. It's wonderful. When this thing started to go out, that's where all our hits came from, because the people in the salons were, like, saying, oh, my gosh, you see what's happening in San Francisco. And we started getting hair. The Chicago Tribune called us. We got, you know, Scientific American, you know, L.A. Times. Everybody was like, you know, I was at my salon today, and they told me. So first of all that hair had to go somewhere. So we talked to St. Vincent de Paul Society of Lane County, and they had a warehouse out here in San Leandro, DR3, and they donated space to us to start accumulating the hair between, you know, making the mats. And they so we were saying, you know, my God, we should work out a green jobs program for this. So, yes, that's the next thing. We're hoping to get in touch with Van Jones. He's got the best of, I know that they've got a lot of stuff on their plate, and this is in no way solidified, but that would be a terrific place to go. We love him. They do things with recently incarcerated people and at-risk youth that trying to, you know, find a pathway out of poverty, and making hair mats would be ideal for that. It could be a generating income for them. They could sell the mats wholesale back to the growers, but they could also donate mats whenever there's an emergency oil spill through us. So that would, again, that's just another great way that this whole thing is going. Plus, we've been hearing about all kinds of other alternative spill, you know, things that are out there. But basically, right now, this is where we're looking at, and it's so great so far.
Okay, well, we're just about out of time for today, so I'll remind our listeners that you can catch us every Friday here at 1 p.m. on KPFA. The show is Terra Verde, or if you miss us, you can listen to a recycled version through our online archives at kpfa.org. And Paul Stamets, the mushroom man who could not make it on the show today, if you missed your chance to pledge during our last fund drive, his book, Mycelium Running, was one of the thank you gifts we offered. It's still up on our website at www.kpfa.org if you want to make a late pledge and pick up a book that'll tell you how mushrooms can break down toxic waste, among a lot of other things. Thanks to Erica Bridgman for engineering this broadcast. My guest was Lisa Gauthier, Executive Director of Matter of Trust, and you can check out her website at www.matteroftrust, all one word, matteroftrust.org. I'm Brian Edwards Steger.
Looking for gifts for others or treats for yourself, like a hot springs weekend that you can get while eating from a gourmet buffet, listening to live fiddle and mandolin music, and have it all benefit forest activism? The silent auction will be held Saturday, December 1st, 6 p.m. till 10 at Berkeley's Unitarian Hall, 1924 Cedar Street. You can sip wine and bid on hemp clothes, art, camping gear, movies, dinners, yoga classes, and lots more. Sliding scale admission benefits Bay Area Coalition for Headwaters. Call 510-548-3113 for info. That's December 1st at 6.
And you are listening to 94.1 KPFA in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. The time is just about 1:30. Stay tuned next for Making Contact.
This week on Making Contact.
We have people in these trailer parks who, let alone money to get a bus ticket, come to New Orleans and find work or come to their jobs, they don't even have enough money to pay for the propane tanks that it takes to heat up a FEMA trailer.
It just seems like they're trying to get rid of the problem simply by getting rid of us.
It's called Renaissance Village, but don't let the name fool you. It's the largest FEMA trailer park in the country, located about 100 miles north of New Orleans in Baker, Louisiana. Right after Hurricane Katrina and Rita, thousands were sent to live here. 2 years after the storm, hundreds are still here. On this edition, we'll hear from people living at the FEMA-run trailer park and from those trying to help them get out.